Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Kamila Stępień-Kutera. Welcome in our competition studio. Today I have an honor to meet with Mr. Nelson Gerner.
Hello, Kamila.
We are during the competition, the Chopin competition, and we are all discussing the Chopin's style, what is proper, what is improper, but we shall underline that Chopin's style was very complex. He was the 19th century artist, but in fact we can't just call him romantic composer and that's all.
Yes, I think that if we were going to engage in a deep stylistic discussion, we will spend here the whole night because it is exactly like that. A genius like Chopin is of such a complexity that we cannot shrink him into a few sentences. And it is very hard to say what it is allowed, what it is not allowed. It depends on the performer a lot and on the respect that the performer has for the written score and how he interprets what it is in the score.
So we have many stages in Chopin's compositions, because we have these early pieces, very light and brilliant. And classical.
Yes.
But after that there is real maturity of Chopin when he composes very important and much harder works, harder to play and to interpret, I suppose.
To interpret, certainly. I make a slight difference in this because I think that some of his earlier works, earlier period works, are extremely difficult to perform technically because it requires a lot of panache and a lot of brilliance from the performer. So it is somehow very taxing for the performer. But the works of his maturity, and he reached maturity very early in life, we can almost say that Chopin arrived to perfection suddenly. You know, there was not such a difficult way as in other composers happened, you know, in which they had to strive for that. With Chopin, it seemed that he acquired that, you know, from one moment to the other. It's unbelievable that how his genius arrived to such a complexity at once, very early in life. And so that gives tremendous challenges to the performer, to any performer.
For example, concertos. These are very early works, style Brion, but these are also very dramatic and complex works also.
Absolutely, yes. The concertos have this particularity that the music message that they convey is so strong that they transcend the steel Brian to which they belong. So we have this paradox. They are still linked very strongly to the steel Brian, but at the same time, they are completely far away from them.
There are more paradoxes, of course, because we have this emotional romanticism also, but Chopin was influenced very much by earlier periods, maybe not influenced, but maybe this is not the best word, but he incorporated, for example, classical style into his music very well. And also his deep understanding of Baroque music is something worth understanding.
Of course, I think it is very important for any Chopin performer to fully understand and to be also a good performer, a good interpret of the music that preceded him. And I would think primarily of Bach and Mozart, the composers that he most revered, that he adored. And we can see, when you study his music deeply, not just in the surface, when you study deeply, you see that he's so classic in a way. He's a romantic, but he never left to be a great admirer of the classicism. And that gives you that rare balance that for the performer is essential to have when you play his music.
He never loses the form and the dignity.
No, that's very important in Chopin. Dignity, a certain feeling of great nobility, of aristocracy, I would say. You know, his emotions are always very, very strong, very dramatic in many cases, but always tempered by a feeling of classicism. And that's so wonderful.
If we are talking about his emotions, the very special collection of these emotions are Preludes, Opus 28. We have talked some time earlier about it, but just let's come back to it for a minute. Because you have recorded Preludes, Opus 28 very recently, and you have deeply overworked, if I can say so, this series. What do you find so special in Preludes?
In Preludes, I find so special the fact that if I had to think of a Chopin work that encompasses all his genius in all its complexity, it would be the Preludes. We have in every one of these small pieces, of these miniatures, we have the quintessence of Chopin. I can't think of anything more difficult, for example, than for going for a pianist from the first prelude to the second. They are so completely different in mood. This agitato of just a few lines of music of the first prelude, in which it seems to you that you are never ready to start with it, because the agitato is from the inside, it is not an exterior thing. So you have to be in the mood before actually you start to play. It is very difficult. And then you come to the second prelude that in his time it has been probably acknowledged as music from a mad. You know, it's so crazy, his harmonic. His harmony is really unbelievable. He was 30, 40 years ahead of his time. And it's such a dark, such a lonely piece of music. Nothing to do with the world of the first prelude. And then again, you go to the third is more a piece for the salon, but nevertheless wonderful, so fresh, so full of air, so full of, you would think of, just a spring source, you know, and in any case, a spring landscape, you know, of the highest quality, yes? So they are all so different in character, and you don't have time. You just have a split second to go from one to the other. So that's why I think of this particular cycle as one of the greatest cycles in the history of piano music and of music altogether.
What a challenge for young pianists.
Incredible. The challenge is huge. Yes.
And you have to build this unity of the cycle.
At the same time, because these miniatures require for a lot of psychological mobility to go from one to the next. But then you have to have the power of construction, because the cycle is indeed that. It is not a succession of miniatures. It is a tremendous entity. When we finish by the last prelude, it seems that we have faced a range of emotions indescribable by its greatness.
I wonder, you have so strong emotions and feelings connected with Preludes, because they are now your own so much, if I can say so. Is it hard to have a distance when you are listening to other performers of Preludes? How can you forget about your own interpretation?
Well, I was exactly discussing that with the team of Polish TV. Because I think that it is not important to find a pianist that has to represent our ideal. It is important to have to find the pianist, to discover a new personality who has exactly that, something new to say, and something that it is entirely his own, his or her own. You know, so at that moment I have to forget about my ideal interpretation, because it doesn't count. It can count, but only on the background of my subconsciousness, but no more. If I put it on the forefront, then I'm doing a mistake as a juror. You know, and this is my duty. My heavy responsibility is to respond with fairness to what the pianist is trying to do. And it could be opposite of what I think. But if I'm convinced...
My guest was Nelson Gerner. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Camila. It's a pleasure to talk to you.